And welcome to Amelia United Methodist Church this morning. I must say it is very good to be back. There's something about being at your home church every week. Announcements today. I have a big one. We are done with Praise Palooza, so we move on to the summer picnic. That is August 21st. If I'm not mistaken, there is a slide, so when it comes up, it is accurate. I probably am not. August 21st at Batavia Park, after service, I think. So if you have nothing to do, come on out and enjoy yourselves. There will be a sign up in the narthex here in the future. Another announcement I have is that Missions is having a rummage sale on August 13th. So start saving your items. If you are interested in volunteering, you can see Barb Benson. I have her phone number. If you want to see me and get her phone number today, you can. So let's see, there's volunteering needed from 10 to 3, and people are needed early to price items. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. I can give you as much detail as I know, or you can see Barb. Let's see. I don't think there's any other announcements. Does anybody have anything? Okay. Well, then let us welcome Christ into our service this morning with some silent prayer. In the name of our Savior, amen. I'll be reading from Psalm 40, verses 1 through 3, and 16 and 17 this morning. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who long for your saving help always say, "The Lord is great." But as for me, I am poor and needy. May the Lord think of me. You are my help and my deliverer. You are my God. Do not delay. This is the word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. Please stand and join us as our praise band sings these Lord's praises to our Lord and Savior this morning.
There's a bunch of old ones, but they're good ones.
Thank you.
having fans.
I'll hide me.
Good morning, everyone. It's time to pray. But let me begin by sharing with you some really good news. It says, praise the Lord. One of our Anna's classmates, Austin, was baptized at a youth camp last week. Pray for this new relationship with Christ. That's good news, isn't it? I love baptisms. Then we have Stacy's friend and co-worker has breast cancer, and pray for her. And then Judy Shepherd's asking prayers for 84-year-old sister Lois. She's dealing with a heart condition. And continue prayer for niece Brenda and her husband Gordon. So we want to remember them in our prayers and in our praises this morning. Am I missing anything else? Any other? Okay. Any unspoken prayers? Okay. All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our God, we come today to offer you our praise, to learn, to hear your voice. We come as a community of believers, Lord. And Father, you know that there are a lot of unspoken requests. You've heard the requests that have been read. And Lord, we just pray for your healing touch on those that are sick. And we first of all give you praise for the baptism. What a wonderful thing for a young person to come forward and profess their faith. And Lord, we do pray that this new relationship with you just flourishes over that young man's life. Father, there are so many people in this community that need you. Many don't know you. And Father, as this church moves forward, I pray that you would give us the knowledge and the courage to be able to invite, to share the gospel with those whom you place in our paths. Father, we know that there are people in this community that are just struggling emotionally and financially. And Father, we know that you will provide. And you do that through normal means, such as people like us. So, Father, just also touch our hearts to continue to be generous, to be able to provide for the needs. The economy is not great, but you are. So we put our trust in you. So, Father, what a privilege it is to be here today, to worship you. And, Father, it is so great that not only do you hear our prayers, that you respond. Father, I pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon this congregation, all who are gathered here today, that we may be a blessed people, that we may be faithful to you and to each other. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Special music by Norm. I heard him earlier. He was doing good with those fingers. You are. I'll be back. The children may be dismissed for junior church. Okay. Today's scripture reading is from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. If you'd like to follow me along in your Bible, I'll give you just a second to get there. This is a story that you've heard probably many times. But it's one that deserves repeating again. It reminds us of so many important things. And it begins as Jesus and his disciples were on their way. He came to a village, Bethany, where a woman named Martha opened her home to Jesus. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that she had made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work myself? Tell her to help me." Jesus replied in a kind and gentle way, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things. But few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken from her." This is God's word for God's people. Praise be to God. Today's scripture reading conveys a real essential truth. It reveals that that the highest priority in a Christian's life is that of loving God. You see, our story begins when Jesus and his disciples come to the home of Martha in the town of Bethany. Now, Bethany is about 2 miles outside of Jerusalem. Both Mary and Martha were devoted followers of Christ. Martha supported Christ in so many ways. One of them was financially. Both Martha and Mary, they loved Jesus, and Jesus loved them. We learned several things this morning about what it means to love God from the interactions of Mary and Martha. First, the scripture tells us that Martha opened her home to Jesus. As an expression of our love, we too need to open our homes to the Lord and invite Jesus into our lives. Invite him into every part of our lives and into our innermost being. You know, it is an invitation that Jesus is eager to accept. I want you to visualize for just a moment in your mind's eye as I read this. From Revelations 3:20. It says, and this is Jesus, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me." What an absolutely wonderful promise. Jesus stands at the door knocking, eager and willing to come into our lives. By opening ourselves to Christ, God's presence is revealed to us in a very personal and intimate way. And in this intimate relationship, it is there that we can truly find comfort for our soul. A way that we can express our love for God is to put him first. Now, you would think that that would be a no-brainer for the average Christian, putting God first in your life. We've heard countless stories. We've heard many sermons, read many books that say the Christian should always put God first. Now, you think that would come easy for Christians, people who love God, but the truth is, it doesn't come easy. And the reason is that there are so many things that are competing for our time and energy. We often overlook the really important things, and yes, even the most important thing of all, being in an intimate relationship with God, always putting him first. There's nothing in this universe that is more important than God. Living a life that honors God requires a sincere desire and a commitment to self-discipline. You know, the truth is, I've never, not once in many years, preached a sermon out of my strength. It is always my weakness. Things that I struggle with, and I'd like to share that with you this morning. You know, things aren't easy. You get so distracted that sometimes the best we feel like we can do is to give God our leftovers at night when we lay there and we're so fatigued and tired and all the noise is taking place in our heads. That's why we have to have a sincere desire and a commitment to self-discipline. That's why it's critical for the Christian to be very intentional about establishing priorities for their life. It's not something that comes easy, and it's easy to be distracted, and I am the king of distraction. You know, you may or may not know this, but up until about 10 years ago when I had a heart issue, I was a Ritalin kid and had been for many, many years. And it really is hard for me to focus. And I have to work on that. You know, sometimes I will lose my attention span or start doing one thing and then I get drifted away. You know, that happens a lot in our spiritual life. We have a desire to sit down and read Scripture. But yet something comes up. You know, someone on the Reds hits a home run. And you got to run to the TV because it doesn't happen that often. You know what I mean? It's easy to get distracted. But yet we allow the world to do that to us as a believer. You know, it's really clear our first priority as a Christian is that above all things, desiring Christ's presence in our lives. That's the number one priority. That is evidence of our love for God. Now, the Christian should be eager to spend time with Jesus. It shouldn't be one of those things where you kind of have to drag yourself in. We should be eager to sit at the feet of Jesus, eager to learn from him, eager to follow him, and to live a disciplined life that is pleasing to God and one which honors God. Now, to better gain appreciation for what's taking place in this scripture reading, it's really important to understand context. You see, in those days, there was a great divide between men and women for what was customary. Men did this and women did that. The primary role of a woman at that time was one of cooking, cleaning, taking care of the children, and caring for the home. Now, ladies, don't get too upset about that. We've made a lot of progress in the last 50, 75 years. So things are looking up. But in those days, that was the role of a woman. Now, the men, on the other hand, they kind of were the breadwinners. They were the head of the household. So, see, I told you I lost it a little bit. But they were the head of the household. So what Mary was doing was so counterintuitive to what the customs of the day were. You know, Jesus or Martha invited Jesus into the house. And Mary runs to get the best seat in the house. She sits at the very feet of Jesus. She had a front row seat. She didn't care if that seat belonged to anybody else, which it actually did. That seat was a seat of honor at the feet of Jesus. It was for the chief disciple. But Mary didn't care. She was ready to break all paradigms so she could come and listen to Jesus' every word. You know, the second priority of a Christian is to be hungry to hear the teachings of Jesus. Mary was captivated by everything that Jesus was saying. She didn't want to miss a word. She kind of phased out everything other than Jesus. Everything else was a blur. Now, you and I today, we don't have that luxury of being able to physically sit at the feet of Jesus, to hear him speak to us in an audible voice. If we could, that'd be really cool, wouldn't it? It could be frightening. It could be challenging. If you were sitting at the feet of Jesus right now, what might he say to you? Now, we may not be able to physically sit at the feet of Jesus, but what we can do is to draw near to Christ through his Holy Spirit. We can pause from all that is competing for our attention and spend time in prayer, enjoying just being with Christ, and know that Christ is present with us. Sometimes I like to be in prayer and say nothing. To sit there not wanting anything, but just spending time with Jesus. In the quietness, I gain peace. And I also listen for what he might have to say. He usually does that by placing something on my heart. And I enjoy that peace and that solitude. Now, a change that we have made in a worship service, one change that I really love, and it takes place right after the announcements. Laurel invites us to pause for silent prayer. You see, I like this time because it sets the mood. And it reminds me what I'm about to experience is much more than a church service. I am reminded the purpose of me being here is to worship God and to experience his holy presence and to do all of that within a community of believers, with you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, during this service, I try to listen to what God wants me to hear or understand through prayer, reading, scripture, and Ed's preaching. In fact, one of my regular prayers to start the service is for God to remove all my distractions so that I can give my full attention to what God may be saying to me, what's going on in the service. This opportunity to listen to teachings of Jesus Christ, that's not just a Sunday kind of thing. Our quiet time with the Lord can bring significant joy to our lives. Have you ever prayed, and after your prayer time, you felt this warmth in your heart, in your soul, where you have experienced a peace? The time we spend in scripture and prayer helps us to understand the will of God and what God may be calling us to do or not do. When we pay attention to scripture and God's Holy Spirit, God provides guidance for us. You know, when an important decision comes my way, I have to remind myself, it'd be a good idea to ask God what he thinks and to pray. Sometimes I forget. Now, I am going to officially retire from my day job at the end of this year. And I work at a place that has a Christian environment. Several years ago, we made a decision that we would not have a meeting, whether it be internal or external, where we didn't begin with a prayer, asking God for wisdom and discernment to help us see opportunities and to see things that God wants us to see and do. It's always fun to do that when you have a vendor come in who's not a person of faith, but that's okay. That was a commitment we made. And when we make a commitment together, it's easy to remind someone of that commitment if they get distracted or sidetracked. Now, our scripture moves to Martha. Scripture tells us that Martha is distracted by all the preparations that need to be made. Here, Martha isn't doing anything wrong. Extending hospitality was really important for the Jewish people of that time. She's in the kitchen, taking care of all that needs to be done so she could serve a meal to our guests. Now, I want you to kind of get this in your mind. So, have you ever done anything prepared for a Thanksgiving dinner, or maybe even something at the church? And you're busy working, and the person who told you that they would help you is sitting there gabbing for an hour while you're sweating and getting the work done. That's what Martha was experiencing. She had the most important guest in the entire world. And Mary was sitting there at the feet of Jesus. Although Martha was doing nothing wrong, she missed a wonderful opportunity. She really missed out. The third priority of a Christian is to take advantage of opportunities to have a personal encounter with Christ. There's always work that needs to be done. There's always things that need to be taken care of. There's a lot of demands on our time. Martha invited Jesus into her home, but she became more concerned about doing things than being fully present with the Lord. Has that ever happened to you? That you got so busy doing maybe church stuff that you missed that opportunity to be fully present with the Lord? It was a perfect opportunity for Martha to have a personal and intimate encounter with the Lord. Many of us do the same. We invite Jesus into our life and accept him as our Lord and Savior. And then we get so busy doing things, before you know it, we become distracted from deepening our relationship with a risen Christ. One of the things that I really enjoy is being around a new Christian. Someone who has accepted Christ and had that heart, their heart strangely warm, as John Wesley would say. And they're excited about their faith. They tell their friends about Jesus. They're ready to come to church and to Bible study and to learn and to be around other Christians. But as time goes by, they begin to slip away, spending less time with the Lord day by day. And the best analogy that I can come up with is that of marriage. You know, when I met Helen, now she's pretty good looking now, but she was smoking when I met her. She was young, she was hot. And there wasn't a day that went by that I just didn't, I wanted to be with her every day. I couldn't imagine a day without her. It was intense. We'd be on the phone talking all the time. She captured my heart. But you know, over a period of time, what happens in marriage, don't you? We begin to lose that. We still love one another. But that intensity, that newness of a relationship begins to become further and further apart. And before you know it, you're sitting at Poochie's. You're having breakfast. You're looking at your phone. And you don't say a word to each other except for, who's got the check today? Well, that's a lot about what happens in the life of a believer. We lose that excitement. The fourth priority of a Christian is to keep the main thing the main thing. Now, Mary had enough. She was pretty frustrated. Or Martha had enough. She was very frustrated. She was tired of doing all the work herself. You've been there. It was time to turn to Jesus for help, which normally would be a good thing, to call upon the Lord when you're frustrated and distracted. But this was a little different. Because Martha said to Jesus, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do all the work myself? Tell her to help me. Get with the program, Mary. Now, unfortunately for Martha, Jesus didn't respond the way that Martha would have liked or expected. Jesus said, and he said it in a very kind, loving way. And you can tell this by, he uses Martha's name twice. He says, Martha, Martha. You're worried and you're upset about many things. And here's a key line. But few things are needed, or indeed, only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken from her. She chose the right thing. She kept the main thing Mary did. You know, it wasn't Martha's busyness that Jesus called to account. It was her being distracted, her worry, and her lack of focus. I believe the point Jesus is trying to make to Martha is not to get so rattled and caught up in getting all the stuff done. The most important thing is to remain close to Christ and to listen and hear his voice. You see, my friends, that is the main thing. Have you ever ran across someone who was not really good with making decisions? They seemed to always make the wrong decisions, or their decisions didn't go well for them. And you may know somebody who seems to always be on target with their decisions. But I have to tell you that when it's all said and done, the only decision that we make in life that really means anything is our decision to bring Christ into our lives and to accept him as Lord and Savior. That, my friend, is the main thing. Our relationship with Christ is the most important thing. You know, and the key thing is he always welcomes our desire to be with him, to learn from him, and for us to show our love and gratitude to him. Jesus did not send Mary away as Martha wanted. And here's the thing. God will never send you away when you are seeking God. God is always there with open arms, inviting you, knocking on the door, hoping that you'll answer and invite him in. The one question with the Christian is, how far do you let him in? How far into your life do you let Jesus in? Do you let him into the foyer? Or do you allow him to come deep into your home, deep into your heart, where nothing is a secret, and that he is the main thing? I think that's hard. We don't want to disappoint God. But the reality is that there are no secrets with God. God is always wooing us. He's always drawing us near. The key is, will we go? Will we want to be in his presence? You know, like Martha, there's a lot of things that can distract us or get in our way of furthering our personal relationship with God. You know, most of us really are busy, aren't we? Or at least we think we are. There's always stuff to be done. It doesn't matter where you're working, whether you're retired or you're raising children, the demands on us can be great. And sometimes they can feel overwhelming if we let them. That's why it's so important to make room for Christ in our everyday lives and to be intentional about deepening our relationship with Christ. To have that relationship where the first thing that you think about is calling upon the Lord, maybe to reduce your burdens. My mom introduced me to a kind of a weird habit. When I was growing up, my mother used to verbally talk to God. She'd be doing something and she'd say, you know, Lord, this refrigerator door is not opening. Can you open it for me? And I find myself every once in a while being very audible and asking God for something. You know, she used to say, "Lord, where are my glasses?" And he would respond, "Hey, Edith, they're on your head." So that's a good thing, that you get so close that Christ is the first person that you turn to. All this is not easy. It requires discipline. It involves making Christ a priority in our life. And it involves making a desire to do this. I want to share a story with you. Many of you probably have heard this, but I think it deserves repeating again. There's a story that is often told about a philosophy professor. Now, he stood before the classroom one day, and he had all kinds of stuff on his desk. And when the class began, he picked up this large empty jar, and he proceeded to fill it with rocks. And they were about 2 inches in diameter. He then asked his students if the jar was full. They agreed it was full. After all, he was the teacher. So the professor then picked up a box of pebbles, and he poured them into the jar, shaking it along the way, so that those little pebbles would begin to fill those empty spaces between the rocks. And then once again, the professor asked, "Hey, is this thing full?" Now the students were catching on at this point, and they chuckled, and they said, "Yeah. Indeed, it is full." Now, the professor picked up a box of sand, and he poured that into the jar, and he began to shake it again. So even that filled some of the crevices. The jar was truly filled. "Now," said the professor, "I want you to recognize that this jar signifies your life, that the rocks are truly the important things, such as family, health, your personal relationship, and most importantly, your relationship with God. If all those rocks were lost, or all those things in the jar were lost, and only the rocks remained, your life would still have great meaning. The pebbles are the other thing that matters in your life, such as work and school. The sand signifies the remaining stuff and material possessions. Now, if you put the sand in the jar first, there's no room for the rocks or the pebbles. You know, the same can be applied to your lives. If you spend all your time and energy on the small stuff, you'll never have room for those things that are truly important. For the Christian, the really important stuff is spending time with God, deepening that relationship with the risen Christ. So this morning, let me ask you this question. Is spending one-on-one time with God your most important priority? If not, I'm going to invite you to consider making Christ a priority in your life, the number one priority. I know it's hard. Things are taking up your time and energy. But remember, you've got to put the main thing in there first into your life, or sometimes you just won't be able to get it in. And if you do, I promise this to you. When you make God a priority, when you sit at the feet of Jesus, when you listen to the word of God and you respond, life gets really, really, really good. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we live in a world that quite honestly seems to just want to suck all the energy out of us. There's so many things that compete for our time. And Lord, we know deep down inside that you are the main thing. But yet, we allow things to distract us. Father, we ask for forgiveness on that. And Lord, help us to grow in our Christian walk. Help us to better understand the importance of putting you first in our lives. And God, may all this be a sign of our love for you. This I pray in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As you leave this place, go. Go be kingdom building people, putting Christ first in your life and sharing Christ with the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in God's peace and grace. Amen.